Right, I think we can start. I'd like to welcome you all to this roundtable discussion. I'd like to also welcome our panelists, including ambassadors, Mr. Mark van den Weert, President of Belgium, Mr. Martin Rover, President of Estonia, Mr. Pauli Mokele, Ambassador of Finland, Mr. Jan Versteeg, Ambassador of the Netherlands, Mr. Luc Feeney, Deputy Head of Mission in Sea of Ireland, and Pauli Nathans Reeves. In addition to these speakers, we have Dr. Papanikos, Dr. Skouras, and Dr. Kouvertz. I'll be introducing each of them during this discussions. I'd also like to welcome delegates from the diplomatic offices of Luxembourg, Montenegro, Britain, Switzerland, Norway, and the Arab Republic of Egypt. The topic of this discussion is the Eurozone's sovereign debt. Now, while the sovereign debt problem has been most pronounced in only a few Eurozone countries, it remains a realistic problem for the Eurozone area as a whole. The topic under discussion comes at a very important time here, as you all probably know, at a time when the country is gripped in a presidential electoral process, which under normal circumstances should run smoothly. But this is an electoral process that is being conducted against the background of a severe economic crisis with crippling austerity measures that have enveloped the country for the past 6 years or so, which have led to deep divisions across the political and social sectors on an ongoing basis. And these are now even threatening the collapse of government. I'll ask each of these speakers to present their own viewpoints on Eurozone sovereign debt in not more than 10 minutes, each of us. And then, after they've all spoken, we will open the floor to discussion. We can start with our first speaker, Dr. Papanikos, who is the head of the president of the Athens Institute in Education and Research, Athena for short. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, thank you for being here.
It's exciting times. Greece is at the spotlight again. We're going to change the world. That's what we believe, at least. But I'm going to talk about the Greek debt and how the other countries can save us, because we're in huge debt. So my plan is to talk actually about the different alternatives, different options that Greece has. And I'm going to talk about four options, actually. One option, realistic options. One option is unilateral default on all or part of sovereign debt. A lot of people use to say Greece has default. That's not true. Unilateral default means I don't want to pay. Second, I'm going to talk about unilateral enforced austerity. Third, which is the most important thing, is debt restructuring through negotiations. And my own views that ideological biases that comes with my upbringing within the Social Democratic Party of Greece and, of course, Europe, a tax on wealth to pay the excess public debt. By the way, just to tell you that this proposal was part of the Labour Party's in UK campaign 1974, but they never implemented. There is a lot of literature about to tax wealth, and in Greece, I think, is the most appropriate, taking into consideration the tax evasion. Now, let me see the problem. The problem, if you look at the Euro 12 and the USA, there's no problem with Europe, because USA has more debt to GDP ratio than the European Union, than the Eurozone, or the initial 12 countries of the Eurozone. The problem arises because some countries, there is a huge difference in the Eurozone in terms of debt. And if we use the threshold of 100%, then you will see which countries they have a problem. Greece, of course, with 175%. Whatever is over 100%, according to the economic literature at least, it's a problem. I'm oversimplifying, but we have to use some numbers just to show which countries have a problem. Now, this is, I think, one of the most important graphs that I want to show you. It is in the literature. I have a paper for that. If you want, I can send it to you. Now, it in the literature it says that when your debt to GDP ratio is below a certain threshold, then it's good for your economy. If it's above that, it's bad for your economy. What I did, I took the Greek data, and then I found out that, just the data actually, that 100% gross debt to GDP, it appears to be conducive to economic growth, promotes economic growth. After 100%, the impact is negative. This is an idea that has been debated a lot by Reinhardt and Drogo and made a lot of published. I did more than that. I saw the relation between Greek public debt and total investment. This is a very important curve because it says that the effect is negative on total investment. There's a reason for that. Apart from economic growth that can be promoted through demand effect, from the supply side, from total investment, the impact is negative, irrespective of what level of debt to GDP ratio we have. And I saw some figures about employment as well. After 120%, you can see it's negative. And just I want to show and tell you in conclusion that debt is bad for Greek economy. And we had debt more than 100% throughout the Euro years. Now, what are the alternatives? So we have excessive debt. And what are the alternatives? Now, in the political debate in Greece, actually, both the official opposition and the government, if you see their conflict, their debate, is not about the four alternatives that I gave you before, but only who negotiates better. If we take it, like Syriza says, I'm going to go to Europe and negotiate better than you. And this is the argument, this is the main argument. It's not the argument about that we don't need negotiations. Nobody says, apart from the Communist Party of Greece or the right wing, that unilateral default, but these parties, they are against Europe. They're not against Eurozone only. They have a more general agenda. So what I did here in this table, I don't have time to discuss it, but it says growth, public debt has been very bad for Greek growth. It's below the long run Greek growth after 1960s, from 1960 to 2014, was about 3.1%. Because of the debt, we are running under 1% or even negative. So we have to fix this problem. This is an answer to the question, how did we get there in the Euro years? I'm not going to spend a lot of time unless there is a question, but 80 billion euro of the debt that was created in the Euro years was due to excessive public wage increases. And my argument is these guys should pay for it. 80 billion euros. If the public wage in Greece were at the average or the same level as Germany, then we would have public debt less by 20 billion euros. But I like to spend time here. That's my view. Look at this here. There are four options here. We have haircut, we have debt maturity, and we have interest rate. So when you negotiate about three things. The official opposition in Greece says, we're going to have a haircut. Some they say, let's negotiate the debt maturity, extend the time. And some others say, let's negotiate the interest rate. Using numbers for interest rates, 1.08%, 3.6%, very valid. Real interest rates, 1.8%, 6%. Just think that Greece has borrowed money with less than 1%. And some people, they say that we've been exploited. Now, what I use here as four scenarios is we have a haircut of 120 and no haircut. We have a haircut of 120 billion euro and no haircut. And we have a default of all the 300 euro. Look what happens. If the interest rates are the ones that I outlined here, all four options have the same impact. So the question is irrelevant. Doesn't matter if you have a haircut or no haircut, if this is balanced by a higher interest rate. Now, but look what happens. If we assume that the private sector in Greece borrows 200 billion euros as well, And we know very well that the 200 billion euro will continue to be part of the debt that has to be paid. And if you include that, then haircut is not a good option, making certain assumptions. So the best option is to have a low interest rate and, of course, 30 or 50 years. Just I'm going to add something to show my social democrat ideology. Who will pay for the debt in terms of debt maturity? Look what happens here. If we have 30 years maturity, the current generation will pay, sorry, if you have 50 years debt maturity, the current generation will pay 8 billion euro. If you have 30 years, the current generation will pay per year 13 billion euro. So what we are doing actually, and politically I have a discussion in my paper, when you ask for longer debt maturity, is asking the future generation to pay for your debt. And I have another beauty, a final, is taxing wealth to pay the debt. I have a solution to the Greek debt problem. One is that we don't negotiate at all, and we pay for our debt, because Greece, believe it or not, is a very rich country. Has a lot of people. It's the top in the world per capita income. Has accumulated tremendous wealth, and they have the money to pay. The problem is political, because the privileged classes of Greece, they don't want to pay for their debts. Thank you very much.
Right, our next speaker is Dr. Thanos Skouras, Emeritus Professor of Economics at the Athens University of Economics and Business.
Stabilized and hovering at about 60% for the previous 10 years. And obviously, to put it in perspective, if you compare it to the United States, it's lower. And of course, compared to Japanese, the Japanese debt ratio is very good. The debt crisis was caused by the preceding banking crisis, to which it is inextricably linked. I'm quite aware that this requires some elaboration. Unfortunately, I will not be able to elaborate on this because of time constraints, but I'll just give you my conclusion. It was very aggravated by the fundamentally flawed architecture of the European monetary system. And the Eurozone's imperfect architecture needs to be completed in two crucial ways. First, with the creation of a common European Treasury, and second, with an enlargement of the ECB's moral, enabling it to act unfettered as a lender of last resort for both financial institutions and the European Treasury. There are two types of major obstacles to the completion of the Eurozone's architecture. The first pertains to the realm of ideas and the proper understanding of what is required. And the second has to do with the sphere of economic and political interests. As regards the understanding of the present European ailment, it has already been argued that the emphasis on public debt rather than banking frailty is mistaken. Belief that the basic problem requiring urgent attention and appropriate institutional reform is the containment of public debt, though prevalent, is quite misguided. Its wide acceptance is due to two factors. The first was the mindset behind the design of the Maastricht rules, which considered that the risk to the euro could only come from irresponsible public spending. The rules were all directed to protect the Eurozone from such an eventuality. The second is due to a historical accident which was crucial in creating a strong, though false, impression about the causes of the European crisis. This was the fact that Greece was the first country in trouble, which signaled to the international public opinion the onset of the crisis. Greece was the exceptional country that fitted the expectations of the Maastricht Treaty, since it was the only one where the weakness of the public finances was greater than that of its banking sector. There was nothing inevitable about Greece being the first country to default. It was the contingent calling of early Greek national elections in October 2009, as a result of boundless political strife, combined with the exposure of the inexcusable falsification of national statistics for political advantage and the post-election disclosure of an excessively high budget deficit that caused Greece's insolvency before any other country. If Ireland had defaulted first, as seemed quite possible at the time, irresponsible public spending could not have been blamed and the nature of the crisis would have been clearly revealed. The second obstacle
to necessary reform is the most difficult to overcome. Germany, which has been indisputably from the start in the forefront of European integration, and is today the only country that can be the leader in the construction of a united Europe, is quite comfortable with the present situation and is against any reform that may involve cost for her. Germany, following the effort for her reunification, does not anymore seem interested in leading towards a federal Europe or even in furthering European integration unless it serves her national interests. Gone are the days that Germany could declare that she had no national foreign policy, only a European one. Today, Germany seems to be concerned with pursuing, above all, her own interests. Despite the claims of Eurosceptics and the belief of large segments of her public opinion, Germany has gained considerably from the existence of the membership of the Euro. The fundamental reason is to be found in the Euro's exchange rate. Given that the Euro's exchange rate tends to roughly reflect the Eurozone's competitiveness and balance of payments relative to the rest of the world, membership in the currency union tends to reinforce the competitiveness of a country that is more competitive than the union average and to weaken further the competitiveness of a country that is less competitive than the union average. To put it differently, membership enables those countries which are more competitive than the average to have an exchange rate that is lower than would have been the case if they were not members, thus leveraging their competitiveness vis-a-vis the rest of the world. Conversely, membership obliges countries with below the union average competitiveness to have a higher exchange rate than what would be the case outside the union, thus reducing further their competitiveness vis-a-vis the rest of the world. Moreover, a currency union with a balanced foreign account shields its members from correction by market forces and allows surpluses by the most competitive countries and deficits by the least competitive countries to develop and be sustained without hindrance. Such imbalances may in fact continue practically indefinitely. This effect becomes evident if we imagine Germany outside the Eurozone. Then its exchange rate against the dollar would tend to be higher and as a consequence it would be less competitive. More importantly, unlike what has been the case while she was a member of the Eurozone, she would find that the surplus in the foreign account is not sustainable. If she attempted to manipulate the exchange rate and fix it at a lower level, she would provoke protest and retaliation from its trading partners. Conversely, if Greece or Portugal were outside the Eurozone, their exchange rate against the dollar could not fail to be lower than it is today in the Eurozone, thus rendering them more competitive. Market forces would ensure in this instance that the exchange rate is corrected so that the foreign account deficit is eliminated. The euro crisis emanating from the global financial crisis has further benefited Germany and reinforced its competitiveness in at least two ways. First, she has benefited through the movement of savings and capital from the risky sovereign bonds and shaky banks of the less competitive countries to Germany.
This has reduced further the cost of borrowing, not only for the government, but also the private sector, strengthening even more its competitiveness. Second, she has also benefited through the movement of skilled and educated young labor force from below competitiveness countries, where youth unemployment has reached unprecedented high levels, Germany. This is of considerable importance in sustaining high productivity and competitiveness, as the rate of population growth is extremely low and Germany is an aging country. In conclusion, it has to be recognized that the euro buttresses and further reinforces Germany's competitiveness, and for this reason, Germany has an interest to preserve it. But unlike the period before the reunification, Germany seems to be distancing herself from assuming the responsibility of European leadership, signaling that she's contented with the present European course and is prepared to pay for the preservation of the euro only the minimum possible price. Germany's complacent stance is that there is no serious flaw in the euro construction other than the poor implementation of the Maastricht rules. What is needed for Europe as a whole is strict adherence to fiscal discipline and structural reform. The belief is that in this way, all countries can improve their competitiveness and become like Germany. But this, even if feasible, which is doubtful, certainly requires considerable time and is not a serious policy option for the pressing needs of the less competitive countries. The fact is that the euro crisis emanating from the global financial crisis has left the less competitive countries in a weak state and heavy debt from which they are unlikely to soon recover without bold reforms of the European architecture. Without the banking union making the ECB a true lender of last resort, without a common treasury or some scheme to enable sovereign borrowing at a low cost comparable to Germany, and without the European investment program in infrastructure sufficiently large to jumpstart growth, they are condemned to stagnation at best. Reduction of public debt tends to lead to fiscal strangling of the private sector and discourages growth. The burden of debt can only be reduced in proportion to GDP if there is growth. But without such reforms, growth is unlikely, if not impossible. The prospect of continued protracted stagnation is politically very dangerous. It breeds the politics of populism, xenophobia, and extremism, which have already strengthened Euroscepticism and are bound to threaten not only the survival of the euro, but even the cause of a united Europe. This is a critical time for Europe and urgently calls for broad-minded and benevolent leadership, which can effectively be provided only by Germany. Thank you.
Professor of
Finance at Syracuse University, USA. Okay. Good afternoon. I don't know anything about the euro. So when Professor Papadikos asked me to serve on this panel, I said, well, I can say a couple things about China and about the U.S. So this is kind of an interlude from discussion on public debt. BIS spoke about, or wrote about the future prospects of public debt. And point out the certain fiscal problems that are larger than official debt figure. Aging population, of course, and increasing unfunded liabilities being on top of it. The fact that large public debts have financial as well as real consequences, such as dependence on foreign investors and increasing risk premium. And impact on capital accumulation that is brought about by the large debt, productivity growth, long-term potential growth that was pointed out by Reinhardt and Rogoff, the question marks, although we disagree, you know, Reinhardt and Rogoff were possible. Part of it at least was discredited, and some of it results, some of the conclusions are still valid. When you look at our countries with highest debt GDP ratio, Greece is way behind Zimbabwe, so I think there's a long way to go before it gets Zimbabwe. It's still up there, okay? But you see some other European countries. Of course, this depends on the year. You know, some of these figures have changed the last 2-3 years. But you see Italy, Iceland, Portugal, Ireland, and Cyprus. So the EU is well represented in this league of high debt to GDP ratio countries. US and China are ranked number one and number two in terms of total debt, but in terms of debt to GDP ratio, US is about 72%, China 22%. But again, that depends on how you count and what you count in here. I'm going to start with China a little bit. The Economist brought to our attention that the dangers that exist and that lurking in this debt in China, whether those are true or imaginary dangers, okay, we can see. Some question, of course, we need to ask about the debt. You know, whose debt is it? Is it central government, local, corporate, household? Is it international debt? So it does make a difference to where the debt comes from and why the debt was generated. And China's debt is a little bit different from Euro debt in that it became apparent that China had a debt issue after the 2008-2009 stimulus, which was implemented as a result of the global financial crisis, and the country started throwing a lot of dollars or renminbi to different sectors. There were really no external imbalances that China is running. The balance sheet of the Chinese government is healthy, and even housing is not as over-leveraged as is purported to be. Corporate debt has skyrocketed, there's no question about that, but it is concentrated on specific sectors, some of it in property, but primarily state-owned enterprises. In property, there's been some correction, and it's going to take a little bit of time to properly correct what happened in property development, but it's taking place. Credit losses are not really that great, even if there is a large amount of default. There's not going to be a big dent on GDP, okay? And reforms with respect to China's debt are necessary, not so much for growth as it is for financial stability. So China still needs to get their banking system healthy, get their SOEs having a lesser say in the economy so that it will become a more stable economy. An interesting case was a few years ago, one of the state-owned enterprises, solar panels, defaulted, and China allowed to default, but it didn't really maintain its posture. After Chowdhury Solar defaulted, some of the other creditors that were deep in trouble were bailed out. As I said, if you look at the overall debt, government, corporate, household, it goes up 250% of GDP, up from about 150% 6 years ago. And the main sources have been the special vehicles that are controlled by local governments, local government debt is a big issue, state-owned enterprise and the corporate developers. Okay. In the U.S., we've been running, it's a different story. In August 14, our debt is expected to be almost $18 trillion. The good news is that the deficit is declining a little bit and is expected to decline, but it's again to grow again after 2016 to be over $1 trillion by 2023. And as you can see, our debt right now, if you want to cut per person, it's about $150,000 that each one of us owes to the government. Okay. Again, if you look at other parts of debt, intergovernmental debt, okay, where we have Social Security, Medicare, and all the other liabilities that the government has, debt is 118% of GDP, not just 70%. And I think that's an error here, 128% by 2025. If you add future unfunded liabilities, Social Security, Medicare, the present value of the debt in the U.S. is 480% of GDP. So the debt problem is larger than what, you know, one sees just by emphasizing the federal government. And interest, of course, just like Professor Pavanik was talking about interest, supposed to be about $1 trillion per year that we'll have to pay just for interest. And the impact would be GDP going down by about 4%. So what's being done? Not much. As you know, we've had almost a stalemate politically. Not much has been done because of a divided house and things, because of our political system, things are probably going to happen until the next Congress comes in, and then we'll see which way the Congress will guide the country. So I don't think there's a will to cut down the debt. I don't think there's a will to stop spending. Okay, so we're going to be paying the price. Yeah. Thank you.
Right, Mr. Mark van der Rea, Ambassador of Belgium.
I have no slides. Thank you very much for organizing this, and thank you also for inviting me to address. First of all, I must say my thanks to Mr. Coveas for the slide on the countries with the highest debt over GDP, because Belgium was not in the list. Actually, maybe
I knew you were going to be here,
before we could be it, because we are actually over 100%. We were under 100%. We went down to something like the slide that Mr. Papanikos showed, and Professor Papanikos showed. We went down in 2007, 2008 to 87, 88%. With the compliments of the bank bailout, we went up over 100% again. Although, one thing that needs to be mentioned, it is public debt, but it is not foreign debt. It is a debt that has been created internally with domestic financing within the country. There is no basic exposure internationally of the Belgian public debt sector. And that is a very important distinction, and a distinction that one has to make, because it does significantly reduce the vulnerability. This is not that we have to downplay this, that we have to say that it's not a problem because we have no international vulnerability, because it does tear away, it does take away quite a considerable chunk of your finance and your capital flows away from productive sectors, that's for sure, but it does reduce the problem in terms of everything that Greece is going through today, in terms with regard to the debtors, with the negotiations about rescheduling and about refinancing and so on and so forth. It's a major distinction that one has to make. Actually, I would like to broaden a little bit the scope of the discussion, because I don't feel particularly comfortable in just refining my remarks on how are we going to handle sovereign debt. Actually, we should start from the beginning. And the beginning is that we started out with a Eurozone that actually by no criterion of macroeconomics does coincide with any criterion of what you would call an optimal currency area. We miss in the optimal currency area the synchronization of business cycles, because we don't have similar or comparable economic tissue structure in our real economies, not enough at any rate. Second, we have not taken care of anything related to bank security. We have been working on that quite hard, quite seriously the last number of years, creating a banking union with the supervision and the resolution systems and whatever we have along with that. So that is something that we can now just make a crossover in the sense that this is not a problem as such anymore that can blow up further again in our face. And thirdly, we have not really taken care of convergence of budget policies. We had that in our minds when we drafted the Eurozone on paper, and politically we forgot about it in 2004-2005 when crucial important countries stepped away from the criteria. We should not forget that. And basically creating a carte blanche, a blank check for smaller countries, older countries, also to break the discipline. And I think that all the evil starts from there. Because actually what we need is three things: reform, reform, and reform. That's what we actually need. Reform in terms of our business cycles and the structure of our real economies to be more in convergence with one another. Secondly, change something about our budget policies and have more convergence in that. And thirdly, the thing that we have already taken care of is in the financial and the banking sector, where we basically did resolve the issue to a great extent. Now, obviously, within the spirit of what we are wanting, of what we want to do in Europe, we want a unified Europe, a Europe that speaks by one voice, a Europe that has the possibility to sustain a major project of monetary and economic unification. But we do need for that budget convergence, and we do need to have cohesion. The major thing that we have to be able to get to, actually the ideal solution for the question that is in front of us today, how do we deal with debt, is actually make it take care of it in solidarity with the common policy of debt financing, which would be the big buzzword of Eurobonds. There's only one question about that: how can we get to Eurobonds without having a convergence of our budget deficits, without having a common approach on these things, and without being all more or less in line with one another on that? Otherwise, I mean, this is not possible. We are never going to get to a common budget financing without having the same or a similar problem in front of us, without having similarities in the problem that we have to deal with. And that is something that we don't have today. I think that we are in the right country today to witness that. You cannot expect from, there is not only a public opinion in Greece, there is also a public opinion in other countries. I cannot imagine a minister of finance of a country that has been lending a lot of money to go in front of his population and say, or in front of his parliament and say, forget about the money that we lent it, we lost it. Because this is simply politics and this is simply a situation that is part of the real world. We should not forget about that. How can we deal with a number of things? I think we have in front of us a number of elements that can be helpful. First of all, we are living in an environment of low interest rates. I think that in one of the presentations that we had before, we had a clear view of how important low interest rates are in getting out of the negative snowball and in order to make sure that we can spin ourselves out of the accumulation of debt through debt service. On top of that, we have also the need for rationalization of our public sector. That does not mean necessarily saving, but spending our money better with better allocation. It's not always about less, it's possibly also about as much as we have in spending, but spend it better. Just a small example in the context of Greece. Greece is spending about 10% of GDP on public health. That's about the figure that Belgium is also spending. That's about the figure that is the average of the OECD countries. Public health over GDP is about 10% across the board in the OECD. Greece is not under that. Does Greece have a proper public health sector that everybody is happy with? I'm absolutely certain that every single answer from a Greek family will be no. And you know what? If there are no reforms in the public health sector in Greece, in absolute terms, public health spending is going to double within less than 10 years. We are now 2014, we're on the edge of 2015. By 2020, it has more than doubled. If no reforms take place, if everything just goes on exactly under the same policy mix conditions as we have today. Result of that, the conclusion of that is quite simple. There is a need for reform of those things. I believe that it is really very important, not only in terms of public spending, but also in terms of what we also need. Because it's true, we also need growth. And we cannot spin ourselves out of the debt issue just on the basis of less interest rates and better spending of public funds. We also need growth. But growth will come also by reforms. Not by reforms as a result in terms of business and a business environment that effectively has improved, but by the mere perception that there is a commitment of society and of the political world for these reforms. We have seen this happen in Greece. We are talking, I'm Belgian ambassador, but we are talking here in Athens, We witness it all together. We have seen that with what has been taking place, whether you like memorandum or not, I mean, this is not about the memorandum, this is about reforms that the country needs. If we look at the situation as is, we have all witnessed that there is a little looking up of the economy that has been there. It is not only by structural funds of the European Union. There is indeed this little spark that has taken place. This has continued. This has to continue. On the basis of what has it happened? Has it happened on reforms that actually have taken ground? Partly, but to a great extent by the perception that there is a political commitment to go forward with those reforms. I think this is at least as important as the effective results of reform. Nobody expects that 20 or 30 years that things have not been run properly, that this is going to be repaired overnight. Nobody expects that. But what is expected is a political commitment to move on in that direction. And I believe that this is not a message only for Greece. This is a message for all of us, because One little thing that I would like to add, beyond the issue of sovereign debt as such, and beyond the issue of Greece, is that the EU population on world basis is 7%. And by 2030, it's going to be 4%. We absolutely have to take care, not only for the sake of Greece, not only for the sake of Belgium, but for all of us, that the 7% of population on world level does not become also 7% of the economic weight that we have. Thank you very much.
Next speaker is Mr. Margus Raba, Ambassador of Estonia.
It is definitely an honor also for me to be invited here to briefly talk about what Estonia has experienced and why in terms of government debt. I want to start by showing a slide which points out that Estonia went through a crisis similar to, in magnitude, quite similar to that of Greece. That happened further down the road. In 2008-2009, our cumulative drop of GDP was 18%, unemployment peaked at 17%. But we came out of it very quickly, quicker than Greece. We did undertake fiscal measures, both on expenditure and revenue side, the same as here. The fiscal consolidation through these years was about 15% of GDP. And we did do some structural reforms, even with a fairly liberal labor market. We did manage to make the redundancy procedures now even more easier. That was accompanied by increasing active labor market policies. Another factor was that during the growth years that preceded the crisis, we did accumulate some reserves. So the state budget for big part of the fiscal years at the beginning of the millennium until the crisis in 2007 was with surplus, and that money was put aside, and that helped us to overcome the crisis. And also what is a difference in circumstances of Estonia and Greece is that our banking system stayed intact, mostly thanks to the fact that it is majority owned by big Nordic banks, and they provided the liquidity and capital necessary, and there was a lot of cooperation between the countries as well. So the basic difference between the crisis in Estonia and Greece is, I think, that in Estonia it was not a debt crisis, but rather an economic crisis that was started by the financial difficulties and aggravated by the real estate bubble in Estonia, which then burst in 2007. And the validity of the measures that the government took is characterized by the fact that we had the same leading coalition party from 2005. And it will be until the spring of next year when we will have the parliamentary elections again. And the same Prime Minister from 2005 until 2014. So he was in office before, during and after the crisis and after taking all these measures. So that takes me to the debt issue. Well, Estonia is a country with very small public debt. It did increase during the crisis, but not significantly, and also from a very low base. It has been increasing during past years after the crisis. Part of it, the visible part of it, is apparently due to the fact that we are part of the European Financial Stability Fund. The fact that the general government debt is only about 10% throughout the years until now speaks of the degree of reluctancy of all the successive governments during the past 20 years to engage in financing the public sector by borrowing. And that has been, we have had right-leaning governments, left-leaning governments before that, but they all have been quite sure on that aspect. So that is a picture from Eurostat webpage, and that shows that in this discussion Estonia is fortunately at the bottom of the league. And it might seem that the Eurozone crisis is indirect kind of crisis for us, because we as a country don't face the problems. But it is a very direct one in two meanings. Firstly, the well-being of euro is perhaps the most strongest guarantee for the economic well-being of the country, which is small, whose geographic location is exactly not an asset but sometimes an ability, and for several other reasons. So everything that happens with euro is very important to us. And secondly, we are already part, even if we are fairly new member of the Eurozone, not the newest, we are part of the mechanisms that are set up to guarantee the stability on the Eurozone level. And there is a lot of political discussion in Estonia about why should a country with a very low debt level and income levels below, for instance, Greece or Spain, be helping others. But the answer has been very simple, because one can attempt to foresee future, but it is not really possible. So one day ourselves might be in the same situation where we might need to go and ask for help. So that is a fairly clear reason for us to be part of these mechanisms, with some questions asked, but not many ones. The experience for the starting point of our membership in Euro has been that we follow the rules, and even if there is a carte blanche, as Mark mentioned, that might be there for breaking them, but following the rules has making life for us simple in some sense, and at the same time we are convinced that one day the others will follow the rules as well, eventually. Even if political and other circumstances are very different in each and every Eurozone member country. And I think about the big question about how to solve the current crisis and what are the ways out of it. I'm not an economist, apart from all the speakers before me, including Mark, so I don't have any clear-cut suggestions, but I'm convinced that all the cooperation mechanisms that are there within the ECOFIN Council of Ministers or the Eurogroup or Central Bank's cooperation, the solution will be found. And I would finish by quoting a saying which is going around in Estonia for decades, if not centuries, which says that something in the lines of borrowed bread does not last long. And that that is something that might have to do with the fact that we have been under German influence for many centuries, also apart from Russian and Swedish and other influences. But whether it has to do with that, I don't know. But the saying is there, and it is also underpinning all these circumstances I have briefly outlined. Thank you.
Finland.
Ladies and gentlemen, I don't have any slides. I have plenty of text to prepare. And coming to the podium of Belgium and Estonia, this is a kind of Nordic lesson. And perhaps repeating some rules and principles or limits for MU. European Monetary Union. Well, I'm coming to my country's view also. But starting from the very principles of the EMU, and there are common rules. There are common rules in the EMU. The financial crisis has shown, however, how important it is that those rules are followed. Many modifications have been made or have been tried to make to complement them since the crisis began. Macroeconomic surveillance has been strengthened. It should be now easier to detect potential problems well in advance and take preventive measures earlier than before, before the problems start to escalate to the whole euro area. In addition, for example, a banking union has been set up in November, last November. The European Central Bank took over the responsibility for supervising systematically important banks. This should contribute to preventing systemic crises and make the investors bear the costs of the risks they take instead of the taxpayer. It seems that there is not much more than can be done within the current treaties to complement the EMU. Therefore, does not seem to be much appetite for going much further in these efforts to revise the treaties either. Given how much has been done in a very short time and for the most part in the middle of the deep crisis, perhaps it is good so. Some of the new rules, particularly on macroeconomic surveillance, seems to be difficult to understand, even for experts. There might be contradictions and overlaps that need to be fixed in the six packs and two packs and other rules which have been drafted in the middle of the crisis. And coming to those promised principles and perhaps lessons Finland could give or has had also in the future. Finland is not very keen on a major overhaul of the present treaty arrangements, so this cautious approach suits us well. Treaty amendments are clearly not a top priority for our parliament either. But there is a strong sense of a necessity to clarify and simplify the rules we have at present. Reluctance to make treaty amendments has not stopped people from making proposals. Of course, many such proposals require that member states give up more of their national powers. There are new ideas floating on euro bonds. A special budget for Europe area is another, and others. And time will show where this discussion is taking us. ladies and gentlemen, Finland has consequently emphasized the following points, and now I come to our, let's say, very principles which have been defended in Eurogroup always and recent times. Each member state must remain responsible for its own financial policy and of its own structural reforms. If this is not the case, who would have the ownership for them? Hardly Brussels or Frankfurt. The Economic and Monetary Union is not a federal system. Budgetary powers still belong to the member states. So the national parliaments bear the responsibility for the national budget. None of the national parliaments seem to be ready to give up this right. If the member state has trouble in balancing its public finances, the markets will sanction it with higher funding costs. The lesson learned. The country concerned has less room for maneuver because of the market pressure. Being pressed by the markets is not a pleasant experience. In Greece, these feelings certainly are shared. Finland had a lot of experience on that and all that in the early 90s. But it is very effective way to guarantee that a country has to take care of its own finances if it's to maintain its freedom of action. For this market pressure to function properly, the principle of no bailout must be respected. That is, each member state must remain liable for its own debts. It is not for the other members to bail it out. Many have argued that the unprecedented levels of financial support given to those member states who have suffered most of the financial crisis, like Ireland, Greece, Cyprus, Portugal, break this principle already. We do not agree. To those who doubt this, I can only recommend a careful study of the so-called Pringle case of the European Court of Justice. I don't go in details on that. If debts are not repaid but written off, there would be no incentive for a recipient member state to conduct a sound budgetary policy. It would be against the basic rules of the EMU. That cannot be accepted according to our principle. Therefore, national parliaments must bear the responsibility for eventual budget deficits of their nation. They should prevent deficits from developing and find the appropriate medicine to deal with them. If they cannot be prevented, only that way can the EMU have a future in the long run. Rules, politics, and markets pressure need to find a good balance with each other. This is not a nice thing to hear when debt levels are very high, but we in Finland have a strong sense of this being only a viable way to secure the sustainability of our common monetary union. The crisis has tested severely the European integration. For the first time, topics of European policy have really influenced average citizens. It has not been a pleasant experience for people in the program countries, and Greece certainly being a dramatic example. Austerity measures have been very harsh, as mentioned, but the global crisis did not leave many of those countries untouched. jobs have been lost and public expenditure has been cut. The public debate has been very lively, both in the program countries and in those member states which have provided support for them. Euroscepticism has gathered pace everywhere. In a way, this should not be surprising either. I have, studied the case of Belgium and Italy also. Those countries formed unified nations already in the 19th century, but still there are internal tensions within the half of a nation feels that it has to pay excessively much of the expenses of the other half. When there are clear limits to how much solidarity can be shown within the countries, there are even more clear limits to how much solidarity we can expect within the EU and the EMU. After all, at least Italy and Belgium, each have national football teams to unite. In the EU, we still have to make progress to reach that level. Thank you.
Good for bullets.
Thank you. Right, so it's time for Mr. Jan Verstier, ambassador of the Netherlands, the magician.
Thank you very much. We're moving back a little bit more to the south again. But I must say that after the introductions by previous speakers, both professors and my colleagues, I will drastically have to adjust the text of my speech because a lot of things have already been said. So I will try to improvise a little bit using a couple of the elements that were in the speech that was prepared. I think I should start on a positive note and referring to the theme of today's discussion, and that is that we think that absolutely sovereign debt in the Eurozone at an aggregate level at this moment is too high, that it should be, that we should do all we can to reduce it, but we think it's not of an order of magnitude that it cannot be managed. And there, if we do the things right, we can absolutely overcome this hurdle. We think that the key thing there is actually to restore growth and competitiveness. Also a little bit what my Belgian colleague said, the key thing to reduce debt to GDP ratios is to work on the denominator, create growth. That is the key challenge. That is the only thing that in the longer term will help us. We've done a lot of things at the European level since the beginning of the crisis. My Finnish colleague gave a good overview of that, I won't repeat it. It is paying off. Also, the instruments that there are to foster reform at the national level through European benchmarks and conditions, you can see that those countries that actually have embarked ambitiously, either in a forced way or voluntarily, on reform are now the countries that have the highest growth levels in the European Union, higher than the average growth in the Eurozone. That is, I think, encouraging. There's of course also a couple of countries that have been reluctant until now to tackle a number of these structural issues. They're facing immense challenges at the moment. In some of these, some of them are rather large countries, the governments have now announced ambitious reform agendas. A couple of things have been set in motion, and it is to be hoped that it will be deepened and continued, because let's face it, the external conditions for the Eurozone countries are basically the same, more or less, and growth differentials are mainly due to differences in national policies. And there I think I also diverge a little bit from what, for instance, Professor Skura said earlier on. I am not convinced that if we look at what caused the current situation, the indebtedness of a number of countries in Europe and a more favorable position of others, that the main explanation for that is the flaws in the architecture of the Eurozone. I'm not convinced of that. And I am also not a supporter of the school that mainly points to the complacent behavior of Germany that has caused this all. I think that there are a couple of factors that are even more important, and actually these are factors that you can do something about, which is also important. There we speak about what actually causes why to come to the Greek case. Why, maybe I should make a little parenthesis here, I very much appreciate that we have this kind of discussion, because I think we have too little of those discussions. We speak too little in a frank way to each other about what is happening. And we all have strong opinions, and we agree in our own little group on these opinions, but the two groups never confront each other. So that's why I thought when we now have this discussion, we should also be as frank as possible and say things that we usually only say to the people that have the same opinions already. So I am convinced that this situation with which the sovereign debt crisis started in a number of countries in Europe was very much related to a phenomenon that you saw very strongly in Greece, and that was that you had these dual deficits with a strong deficit, a high deficit on the current account on the trade balance, and the other big deficit, 15% GDP on the government balance. I think that situation is directly related to differentials in competitiveness between the European economy. Some of it may be caused by the architecture of the Eurozone, but some of it, important part of it, also is caused by a couple of other differences. One Greek friend of mine explained to me that in his eyes the main difference was a different political tradition, different tradition in wage bargaining between some northern and southern European countries. There is probably some merit in that. Another explanation is that the quality of public expenditure, both investment and the consumption of the public sector, was rather different in some countries. And a third factor might have been the business climate. Why were some countries able to attract a lot of investment and others less? There is definitely also something there. Which brings me back to the main point that I wanted to make, and that is that in order to get back this growth, in order to get rid of this very unfavorable balance between debts and GDP, we have to work on economic reform. There are four areas that we will have to address. One of them is monetary policies, the other is fiscal policies, then there's reforms, and then there's investments. On monetary policies, I won't say too much, also for time's sake, that's in the hands of the independent Central Bank of the European Union. On fiscal policies, I think the main point there is that all of this, also whether our debts are sustainable, is in essence about, do markets believe that in the future we will be able to raise enough taxes and control our expenditure as governments, right? So do we have credibility in the markets? And that's why a respect of the revised budget rules that we have in Europe is so important, and that they apply for both smaller and bigger countries. There is some flexibility in them nowadays, which doesn't mean that anything goes, but there are ways to accommodate exceptional situations. Third theme, economic reform, economic modernization. We definitely have a number of issues there. All European countries face a number of big challenges, and unfortunately, often at times of crisis, people say, let's wait a little bit with the economic reforms, because it's now more important to get growth started again. And that's why I would like to echo Eurogroup President Jeroen Dijsselbloem and try to dispel for you three myths about structural reform and growth. The first myth is that structural reforms harm growth in the short term. There's clear evidence that that needn't be true if you do it smartly. There's the IMF's global policy agenda that highlights a number of short-term growth enhancing effects of some labor and product market reforms because they restore confidence, they boost investments. If investors are having good feel for that actually governments are trying to improve the investment climate, they will be much more prone to put their money into a company in a country than when they think this is all sluggish and it will never be tackled. The other authoritative organization that wrote about is the OECD. They calculated that actually the growth effect in Europe of structural reforms can be more than 6% over the next 10 years. Second myth about structural reforms is that they affect only the supply side of the economy, and that is also very much dependent on how you do it. Reforms can not only raise potential growth in the medium term, they can also spur demand in the short term by, for instance, reducing the tax burden on labor or initiate aggressively reforms that deal with the rising cost of healthcare and pension payments. They free up household budgets, which can help to increase spending in economies, and there's a couple of good examples of that. Third myth is that structural reforms come at a cost to the budget. There too, there are a couple of examples that you can do actually very important structural reforms which do not impact the budget, like an increase in the pension age, not always popular, but probably very necessary in most countries, but also reforms to improve the business climate, such as shortening the time to set up a business. No reason not to do that because it would be of impact on the government budget. Thirdly, finally, very briefly on investments, and then I'll turn to the debt issue for 2 minutes. On investments, definitely, we need to try to get the investment level across Europe higher. It's 3 points on that. We agree that some countries could and should probably do more in terms of public investment. What is important there is that it's not just public investment, but it's leveraged by private investment, and we should be very critical about what we invest in, the quality of this investment, because there are also quite strong examples, unfortunately, in Europe of public investments, expenditure of structural funds, etc., agriculture funds that have not led to a strengthening of the economy, but rather had all kinds of perverse incentives that led to a reduction of productivity and did not lead to an economically rational allocation of resources. It disturbed that balance. We think that the overall aim should be to have a new growth deal for the Eurozone where we link these various elements. For instance, we should link the implementation of structural reforms to budgetary consolidation targets. And secondly, we could also use the investment agenda to bring about reforms. So linking the availability of some of the investment funds that become available to a reform agenda that should be domestically made, it should be homegrown. Countries that want to use these funds should come up with their own reform agenda, and then these two things can be linked with each other. Why haven't I said so too much about the public debt issue, and why are we a bit hesitant to give the impression that a drastic reduction of the debt burden of, for instance, a country like Greece is in the making? Everybody will have noticed that lately you don't hear too much about it anymore. There are a couple of reasons for it. We think that already a lot has been done, actually, in 2012 and before. The conditions at which the Greek debt is at this moment structured are immensely favorable. Very low interest rates, long maturities, long grace period. And actually, if you look at the debt service levels in the coming years up to 2022, they're at a totally acceptable level. They're lower than in most other countries, around 5% GDP. And this is not for free, this is all because I think European partners saw that this had to happen in order to keep the Eurozone together, in order to prevent mishaps in Greece. So we think a lot has been done already. If you do more, because for instance we tackled almost all of the privately held debt, if you would start to do more, you would probably also erode confidence in financial markets in many other ways. You would probably prevent any other, let's say, aid operation in the future, because taxpayers will no longer bear by the argument that the money will all come back, and that we think we would weaken the whole construction. And what I also find tempting to highlight that often, and it's not what was said here by previous speakers, but often in this sort of discussions you also hear people say there's kind of a moral obligation of the other countries to do something about this, because the debt burden is unbearable, and why not strike off 50% of that debt? As if that is a solution that comes for free. All this money that is lent to Greece is actually money that we also had to borrow, the lenders. And we borrow that basically from the coming generations. And I think we should take that into account. Nobody was had a lot of cash. Everybody had to go to the market to get this money that we then lended to Greece. And it would be very problematic, I think, for most of our politicians to go to Parliament and say, let's forget about that. So I'm happy that that is a less popular school nowadays to say that we can actually simply do away with it, it's at no cost, because it does come at a cost for other taxpayers elsewhere in Europe. Maybe one or two more words about this, if you allow me. 1 minute? Okay. How will this continue now? There will be a new debt sustainability analysis in the current review. On the basis of that, the Eurogroup will evaluate whether further measures are necessary, and it is said in November 2012 that when needed, and if structural reform is on track, and if also the country itself does the necessary things, then the Eurogroup will look at other measures in a very specified nature. As things stand now, it looks like the debt burden is bearable at the moment, but of course it incurs pretty high primary surpluses in a number of years, up to 4.5% and then gradually going down to 4% again. Is that feasible? I think the Belgian ambassador, for instance, is well placed to answer that question. There are actually examples both in developed and less developed economies that for a number of years countries can actually produce that sort of surpluses. It's not a pleasant thing, but it's I think it responds also to some a feeling of fairness that was also voiced by the Finnish ambassador, and it's not an impossible thing to do for a defined period. I'll leave it to that. Look forward to the discussion. Many thanks.
Thank you. I'd also like to welcome Mr. Luke Beeney, Deputy Head of Mission at the Embassy of Ireland.
Thanks very much for the opportunity to be here this afternoon. My thanks to Dr. Poulos for the invitation, and everybody at the Athens Institute for Education and Research for putting together this roundtable discussion on the Eurozone sovereign debt, which, of course, is a very important subject. So, a car carrying a group of tourists visiting Ireland for the first time stops by the side of the road and, after pulling out a map, asks an old man for directions to a distant location. The man looks at them, looks left, looks right, looks back at the car, and he says, "Well, if I were you, I wouldn't start from here." Unfortunately, that story is analogous to the Eurozone's sovereign debt crisis. I wish we didn't have to start from here. As the only non-Greek program country representative, I'm going to talk about Ireland's debt crisis, which is a little different from other examples, with which you might be more familiar with. Hopefully, it'll highlight that nuanced responses are always best. Ireland's general government debt to GDP ratio peaked at 123.3% of GDP in 2013, and is expected to reduce to 110% this year and continue on a downward path with 95% in 2018. I had a look at the list earlier today, and as we saw earlier, while we're not as bad as Zimbabwe, we are in the top 10 for both gross and net debt as a percentage of GDP. The Belgian ambassador pointed out that maybe they're slightly outside. Not great, especially as debt to GDP was down to 24% in 2007. As we all know, Ireland had an unprecedented boom for 13 years in the late 90s and early 2000s. In a not-so-proud but long-standing tradition, Ireland suffered a classic asset price bubble. From tulip mania in 17th century Holland, through South Sea, to the dot-com bubble of the early 2000s, we had a good, old-fashioned sort of crisis. Our vice was property. The collapse of Lehman and the global financial crisis was the proximate cause. But the asset bubble, driven by domestic demand and cheap international credit, had to pop sooner or later. With the benefit of hindsight, we can see that the fabled soft landing was never really on the cards. Of course, for us, popping in the middle of a global financial crisis was terrible timing. It meant that policy responses on a national, European, and international level were driven by global considerations rather than crisis-specific. The private debt on the balance sheets of our banks, lending to households and non-financial firms, was over 200% of GDP by 2008, was effectively transferred to the sovereign by means of a guarantee of all deposits, bonds, and other obligations of the banking sector. In addition to that, there was another unwelcome aspect to the property bubble in Ireland. Government expenditure became over-reliant on the property-related tax revenues, an unsustainable, fundamentally unsustainable income source. So our multi-annual spending plans were reliant on once-off transactional taxes. When the transactions stopped, the income stopped, but we still had the spending obligations. So to summarize, the global financial crisis coincided with our property bubble bursting. The government faced a collapse in tax revenue, a need to prop up overexposed banks, and increased unemployment resulting in increased social welfare expenditure. Then comes the well-known part of the story. A loan facility in exchange for austerity and reform. The total program was 85 billion, 67 from multilateral and bilateral sources, and then 17.5 from our own resources. Since then, about 18.3% of GDP has been extracted from the economy in a near zero inflation environment. We have recapitalized and restructured the banks, and last December, as you know, we successfully exited our program. More recently, we've secured agreement for the early repayment of a significant portion of our IMF loans. These steps have had the effect of stabilizing our financial system and reversing the outflow of deposits and other funds that was damaging our economy. Unemployment peaked at 15.1% in 2011, has been falling to about 10.7% now. Nominal GDP, and this is pretty remarkable, nominal GDP is forecasted to exceed pre-crisis levels into 2016. Ireland's economy is expected to outperform the rest of the euro area in 2014 and 2015. Ireland will exit the excessive deficit procedure next year. We're rated A by two out of three major rating agencies, which reflects the solid economic growth prospects and improved fiscal position. And importantly, we have fully returned to market financing. Now, slightly more controversially, austerity can be an appropriate policy response in Ireland, as the structure of the economy, particularly with respect to multinational presence, is anomalous. In 2013, our total exports were over 100% of GDP. We trade so much that the domestic economy is not as important to our overall success as in other places. Our customers are overseas, so if austerity policies take money out of the Irish economy, effectively taking it out of the pockets of the Irish consumer, depressing domestic demand, as long as our international customers keep buying, we'll be okay. At least in those sectors exposed to international markets. Effectively, the rest of the world accommodated Ireland's deflation. I reiterate, I'm not advocating a one-size-fits-all policy. That approach simply doesn't work, either in Greece or elsewhere. There must be a tailored, nuanced policy response that is appropriate to the actual structure of each economy. So, in Ireland's case, after 30 billion of consolidation measures over a seven-year period, a very difficult period, our public finances are continuing to show encouraging signs that they're moving in the right direction. Tax revenues show continual growth. Fiscal targets under the excessive deficit procedure have consistently been overachieved. But we still have outstanding issues. And it's clear that if Ireland's crisis happened now, post-banking union, post-single supervisory mechanism, and the single resolution mechanism, which breaks the vicious cycle between banks and sovereigns, as we know, the response at a European and international level would be very different, and the burden would be shared more appropriately. Ireland's positive outlook is tempered by the fact that recovery in the wider union is feeble at best. GDP growth as low as 0.8% in the euro area this year. And that's compounded by extremely low inflation. And as we see it, risks are tilted to the downside. Fundamentally, productive investment in the EU is lagging. It's 15% behind pre-crisis levels. Concerted and creative action is required to get the necessary level of investment flowing again. The investment plan for Europe, which I think has been mentioned a few times, proposed recently by President Juncker, is a positive step. The plan aims to mobilize 315 billion in net additional investments in the real economy over the next 3 years. The proposals, and I think the Dutch ambassador made reference, are designed to attract private investors and will deliver priority projects with both economic and social benefits that would not otherwise have been realized. Obviously, there are still serious questions about the modalities of the plan, especially around the 15-to-1 leverage ratio. However, in agreement with colleagues, in our view, we need to find a way of investing even more. In a 14 trillion euro economy, 315 billion is just a good start. 2.2% of GDP, that's it. The US spent more than double in their stimulus and was criticized for being too small. And we have a bigger economy. They also didn't include as much leveraging. We should be looking at a bigger program raised through pan-European instruments. 1 trillion euro would be a good program and would strongly signal our intent. To conclude and to summarize, the appropriate policy response to a debt crisis is growth. It's working in Ireland and it can work in Europe. A Japanese-style lost decade Eurozone version is what we need to avoid, and stimulus is pushing. Thank you.
Heard the observations of 8 speakers, viewpoints, possible actions or solutions to the sovereign debt crisis. We'll open the discussion to the floor now. And anybody who might want to give the ball rolling? Yes.
Yes, listen to this. I see this EU is like an aeroplane. Three-engine aeroplane driving on 2 engines. Plus, we have fiscal policy, we have monetary policy, and we have exchange rate policy. And the third one, we cannot pursue. Exchange rate change is impossible. And that is the problem, isn't it? Of course, you can police the whole thing. Juncker can be a strong man and press to all the good things that are working. Belgium ambassador tell us about. It is an idealistic way to do. And probably in this idealistic way it can work. But do we want it? Probably not. We also have David Cameron on the other end. And what does he say? He wants to loosen Europe, to split up, in fact. And maybe it might be better. if we could get Greece have a time out on the Eurozone, it might be a good thing. Because it's an exchange rate thing that is a problem.
Shifting Greece should come out of the Eurozone.
Yes.
Are you directing it to any particular panelist, or does anybody want to answer that from the panel? Yes, sir.
I was expecting this to come up one or another moment. I was referring in my remarks to the fact that the European Union is at this moment 7% of the world population. I just want to put one single question. Do you think we have the margin of not pulling on the same side of the string if we want to be sure that we're not going to end up being also 7% of the world economy? Why is the issue of Grexit, which is unfortunately due to the political context of today, again being discussed? Why is the Grexit such an important element? Well, because it would, for the first time since the existence of European integration, be a step back. We do not know where this would end. This is like a snowball that you run down from a hill. You do not know by 1 meter of diameter to which how big it is going to be at the moment that it comes down. You do not know where you're ending up with that. And then on top of that, I would like to mention something else as well. When I said, when you mentioned the word idealistic, you probably are referring to the fact that I was talking about solidarization of European debt. I would like to stress on this that this is something that we have to work to. This is something that we cannot attain unless there is indeed, as our Dutch colleague was saying, proper observance of the reformed budget target, budget policy targets that we have been working out, and of which countries like Ireland, like others, are indeed at this moment showing that it is workable. But giving up on the target, giving up on the objective, because it takes pain and it takes effort to reach it, is the last thing that we really need. That's what my opinion is on this.
Could I just add to the answer that was given by my Benelux colleague, that I think at this moment, at a policy level in other countries of the Eurozone, there's little talk about the Brexit. There is some speculation in Greek newspapers about the Brexit, but it's definitely not the debate that we have at this stage in Europe. We had it a couple of years ago, although also only in very specific places and never too seriously, I think. And one of the conclusions that were drawn at that moment was that an exit from the Eurozone from peace would lead to a fall in GDP in the first year of about 30-40%. I think that after the whole adjustment that we have had now and a contraction of GDP by between 25 and 30% already, it's definitely a thing that you would want to avoid. So I don't understand why people are speculating about this at the moment. I think it's definitely the sort of scenario that will be difficult to control, also in terms of domestic consequences, etc., etc. So the challenge that we'll face now is to make sure that this doesn't happen. And the way to do it is to stick to a number of these reform objectives that we have imposed on ourselves.
What happens next time you want to integrate Ukraine, maybe? So is it fair that we should pay for all countries that are not ready to join the EU? It's been too hasty.
Yeah, but that's a backward-looking question, what if question. I don't find it very useful to answer that. I don't think
that's the bus of the tourist bus in Ireland that you're talking about.
You got to start from there.
Probably we also learn from the experience.
Okay.
Can I add something? Usually when we raise the argument of exchange rate management, the exchange rate is used to balance the external account. But right now Greece has a surplus in the external account. So we don't need actually to devalue the euro US. Right now Greece, starting from last year, for the first time after 2,500 years, if I remember correctly, we have a balance, I'm not kidding, we have a surplus in the trade balance. And I think it's thanks to the Eurozone. For the first time in Greek history, always we had a deficit. So there's nothing wrong with the euro. No, there is something wrong that do with the real effective exchange that we can discuss. But that's different from saying, since we cannot manage the exchange rate, because we can see the history of Greece that they were able to manage the exchange rate. I don't want to go back. Inflation was the result. Nepotism was the result. The previous class of Greece, whenever they had a problem, they went to collar laws and they created money. So I don't want to go back. Unless I want to support the state nearest previous class of Greece. So the exchange rate right now for me is not a problem. For reason, as an economist, we have a surplus in the current account. So nothing wrong with that. What is problem though, is, at least according to my opinion, is the structural reforms. But when everybody talks about the reforms, I don't agree that the reforms should be initiated from Greece. I don't trust them. I think the reforms should come from, imposed from the European Union, which is very easy politically to implement such reform. It would be impossible for Greece, when I present, I say, unilaterally austerity measure, it would be impossible for Greece to implement austerity measure by herself, and they needed the European Union in order to justify it. Because all Greek political parties, they are against austerity measures. And I'm in favor of them. What is an austerity measure? And if you are left, you should support austerity measures. Why? Because it says that we should create a budget surplus, nothing else. The government should not spend more money, okay, than what it can raise as taxes. And I don't see anything wrong with that. On the contrary, I think they should raise more money so they have a surplus, so they can leave it for future generation, because the demographic problem that we have means that we need more money in the future to cover old age, pensions, and so on and so forth. And
for the sake of argument, I think one shouldn't rely on external pressure to reform the country. I think, first of all, reforms will only stick if there is national ownership of reforms. And B, I think we will wreck the European Union if we use this instrument of applying pressure on another country too much, because then you also enable national politicians to say it's not us that impose this, it's the ugly Europeans.
That's what I mean. And I like the ugly Europeans.
but then people will turn against Europe.
In Greece, by the way, if you look at the Gallup, forget about the political parties, for the last, let's say, 10 years before and after the crisis, the pre-Eurozone, the pre-European Union attitude of the people, it's about 80%. Nothing changed about that. So, and a lot of people think that it's necessary, even for the election right now. They say 55% of the people say they don't want the election.
Yeah. But I think the sentiments that you currently see in some zones in Europe about other European countries, telling example, the feelings of most Greeks about Germany at the moment are definitely not something that you want to have within your family. And I see Europe as a family. And this mechanism of applying external pressure, giving the national responsible people the possibility to blame it on the others, has created this situation in which we say things about each other that we normally don't say about each other in peacetime.
I don't agree with you, because there was not even a single incident against German people throughout this crisis, apart from the newspaper. Show me only a single incident.
We had a Dutchman that was mistaken for a German, that was beaten
That's the problem. 75-year-old
tourist that was beaten up because they thought he was German. I find that a scandal.
Let alone Belgians, with because we have on top of that more or less the same colors in our flag.
And somebody shot a Kalashnikov at the German ambassador's residence.
Then in Israel?
Yeah, but I mean, this is leading us all too far. The fact of the matter is, though, that we do need more Europe and not less Europe on these things. And that actually does, everybody has to do a share of that, that simply having monitoring on the European side, by the way, which we have memorandum gone or not memorandum gone, we will still have the European semester being in place. So, I mean, we are all under this kind of control. But I couldn't agree more with my Dutch colleague that we do indeed need an element of ownership, and that we have to take care that we do not push everything back to the European Union, because otherwise the feelings of Euroscepticism are going to take ground much more than what they do today, and nobody has the margin, I repeat, my 7% thing of the world population, we simply in Europe have no margin for go-to-loan policies. Actually, even Germany, which we consider as a big country, is nothing more and nothing less than a medium-sized to a small country on world-scale level.
I don't agree with both of you, because the stability and growth path, if it were implemented and was brought in first by France and Germany in early 20, we wouldn't have any problem right now. And everybody in Europe knew very well about the Greek statistics. Yeah, everybody knew that, and they leave it like that. Because the crisis, of course, the whole thing emerged. But
thank you for the talks that we just heard, because I think they give a good overview over the right perspectives that we have within the European Union regarding this topic. And I also like the example that we have just heard with the plane running on one of three engines. To me, the engines are a little bit different. It's, of course, monetary policy, fiscal policy, and the labor market as a third big part of policy. And we all know that we are not individually handling monetary policy. We are not individually handling fiscal policy within the European Union, as we attached not only to the Growth and Stability Pact, but to the Six Pack and the Two Pack, which is even more important right now. So the one remaining part, in my opinion, is the labor market, and this gives rise to another broad issues that you also mentioned. That would be, on the one hand, what about the wage level? Comparison of wage levels in Germany and other member states of the European Union. We know that suppressing wage levels in Germany led to also to an increase in the trade balance and had a major part of the success within the European Union. So therefore, I wouldn't so much like Greece to take advantage of what Germany did in the past, because that's one of the big objections that most member states of the European Union have against Germany. So that was referring to Professor Spurs talk about should we try to get closer to Germany. But I think you mentioned also that Germany is the one to blame, so maybe Germany is the one supposed to get out of the Eurozone. That would be also something that we should discuss. Everybody else stays and then Germany gets out. And then of course there's also this picture leads to another broad issue that means inequality in the European Union. Inequality between labor and capital. And I think this issue is also very important throughout the member states of the European Union, and brings me back to the very last speaker talking about Ireland. Because I think austerity measures in Ireland are a very good example that countries are not so similar within the European Union. We have numerous studies showing that some countries are so-called wage-led and others are profit-led, and obviously Ireland is profit-led, which means that austerity measures are positive for GDP. Other countries like Greece, but also Austria, are supposed to be more wage-led, which means that those countries would have severe problems going on with their austerity processes. So I guess that we should also open our discussion towards more diverse objections and not following necessarily those growth and stability pacts and line guidelines within the Six Pack. And this brings me to my third part, and I'm stopping immediately. This is the question of should there be any bailouts be done, or do we have any moral obligation? And I think the European Union has just overcome this question already by installing those two-pack measures, because they clearly state that whenever you follow those new measures of fiscal policy, means that we are not talking about deficit anymore, we are talking about our distortionary, that part of our deficit that is the so-called non-business cycle deficit, that is our structural deficit. And we have all done some kind of medium-term objectives, like Austria did, reaching 0.5% of deficit and not 3% anymore. And all the other economies are supposed to do that as well. And once we do that, then we are obliged to have our money coming from the European Stability Fund, which is already in place, to get to give us some bailout automatically, and not the bailout clause anymore. We tried to get off that bailout clause somehow.
Maybe at this stage, just in case we
use
a train of
thought,
ask some of the panelists to answer
it's
to
what you said.
Could I briefly address two points,
yeah,
and then leave the others to other members of the panel? First of all, wage level in Germany. Germany at the beginning of this century was the sick man of Europe. It was totally uncompetitive, and one big problem was the wage levels, the fact that social dialogue wasn't working, etc., etc. Prime Minister Bundeskanzler Schröder has managed to tackle that issue. I have a lot of pain, also a lot of unpleasant discussions about the Stability and Growth Pact at the time, but they exceeded the thresholds. But they tackled that issue, they had their labor reforms, they became very competitive, and they became the new miracle in the world, almost. We actually were pretty happy with that. We think it explains quite a lot of the growth potential in Europe, and I wouldn't be in favor of policies that would aim at raising wage levels in Europe, deteriorating competitiveness of the German industry, which also will have its effect on the wider Eurozone. The second point, austerity. I find the whole debate about imposed austerity measures a little bit misleading. Some people seem to imply that austerity is imposed on countries just for the fun of it, because they think it's in some way it's better. But for instance, take Greece as an example. What was wrong with the Greek economy? That most of the economy was geared totally towards the public sector. Most of the spending went through public investment and expenditure. And there was 15% GDP deficit on the government balance. What can you do then if you don't want to increase debt levels drastically? You have to cut public spending. There's no alternative to that. And that is not for the fun of imposing austerity on the people. It's simply because you want a shift of resources from the public part of the economy to the private part of the economy, and you want to prevent that future generations will face a tremendous debt mountain.
Well, you have to raise taxes and not necessarily cut.
5 o'clock.
We've still got a few minutes.
Okay, that's
it. Maybe you said you wanted to answer.
Yeah,
I'll come to you.
We don't want to have a deficit in time.
Just to fully agree on the point about Ireland, and that's what I was trying to get across, is the nuance required in the policy response at a European and international level to the specifics, the country-specific situation. And Ireland is not a particularly good example at a European level. It's really only Luxembourg and maybe the Netherlands that also have such a significant proportion of GDP from trade, and therefore can export that deflation effectively. But I would take some issue with the Dutch ambassador's intervention regarding Germany, particularly because of inflation targeting. I mean, we have an inflation target of 2% in the European Union, but because of wage suppression in Germany, it's been running at 1% there, which is causing deflation across the Union, which is increasing German competitiveness. If you look at a graph comparison of a French worker and a German worker, the productivity increases over the last 10 years have been largely the same, but the difference in cost is because of inflation. So the wage suppression versus one versus the other is because of the wage suppression.
Well, maybe you give me the possibility very quickly. I don't think there's anything detestable about trying to keep your wage levels a bit down in order to be competitive on the world market. I really don't see that point. It's not anti-social to do that in Europe. And as I said, I think that hadn't they done it, their industry would be in a much worse state, and Europe as well.
Just to clarify, my point is rather that they should have said that when we were setting our inflation target. They should have said that we're going to keep to 1%, not 2%. If you're going to set a target for what your inflation level is going to be, then try and hit that target, the 2% in the Stability and Growth Pact. Don't have it at 1% running separately, because it provides you with an unfair advantage.
I have a question. Maybe just two short questions, two comments.
No, that's okay. I've missed my window. I wanted to reply to something specific.
Talking about labor, we have three freedoms, three or four. Freedom of goods and services is okay, it has happened. Freedom of capital, it has happened. Freedom of movement, it does not happen, it has happened. Why not? Because unions, a set of barriers, it's all about minimum wage. The advantages of getting cheap labor from, let's say, Bulgaria, now I'm from Denmark, is it? We have them, but they're not allowed to be competitive because the unions are there, so we have to pay them a high salary. And so we are even better off.
But you have to remember that it's also the social Europe. There's certain protection of workers.
Forget about that. Because
we have some values, basic values.
She's from Denmark, so she said you're from Denmark.
I think you're very wrong.
From
the perspective, I give you the perspective. Because what is happiness and what makes you happy is incremental things that make you happy. A Bulgarian getting 10% more than he gets at home will be happy. So there's no point in giving him a Danish salary.
There were regulations for transitional periods for those new member countries.
Yeah,
we could come back.
Yes, yeah.
Well, I'll take one more question, a short one, and then we can wind up.
Just about work mobility, what are you going to do about it? Because as I learned, there is some problems for workers moving from one country to another. There is a linguistic obstacle, obviously. So what are you going to do about it to make it easier?
They learn foreign languages. It's not simple as that.
Well, I think that the issue is not so much the restrictions. The issue seen from the perspective of countries like ours, which are on the receiving end of foreign workers from within the European Union, is to make sure that we do away with social dumping. That is a major issue. I'm not so much concerned about the fact that people can't take advantage of coming across to work. I think it is important that we don't get social dumping. And that is basically...
$5 to make $1
I'm talking about...
Right. I think we'll end formally, but if you want to continue with the discussion, thank you so much to all the panelists. Thank you.